Good morning, colleagues. Good morning, witnesses. Welcome to the second meeting of the committee in 2016. Can member remind all members to switch off their phones or at least put them in a mode in which we can't hear them? Straight into agenda item one involves taking evidence on Scotland's fiscal framework. And I very much welcome the witnesses to the meeting this morning. We have Dr. Monique Ebell, Research Fellow at the National Institute of Economic and Social Research, Professor David Heald, Professor of Public Sector Accounting, University of Glasgow, and David Phillips, Senior Research Economist at the Institute of Fiscal Studies. And poor David's carrying a bit of a cold this morning, I think, so we'll try not to be too hard on you, David. And I know you've all come quite a long way, so I'm grateful for you coming along giving us evidence today. It's a very short evidence-taking session, probably just over an hour. So I propose just to get straight into the guts of the real issues rather than ask a sort of general opening question. So if you don't mind, I'd like to get into block grant adjustment issues and indexations to begin with. And David Phillips, in your written submission on page 30, you say that over the period 1999 to 2013, depending on the indexation method used, Scotland could either have some 1.5 billion or roughly 5% of the Scottish government's current budget better or worse off, depending on the method chosen, if we'd been following these new powers, obviously from some time ago. In view then, therefore, which indexation method provides the best outcome for Scotland's budget, and what are the reasons that underpin your choice, and what would represent a fair and sustainable deal for Scotland on indexation? a big question to ask for a man that's feeling a wee bit under the weather, so forgive me.
Okay, so in terms of which method would tend to give the most generous budget settlement to Scotland, our analysis suggests that would be the per capita indexed deduction method, PCID, which is you take the block grant adjustment you make in year one, and then you increase it by the per capita revenue growth in the equivalent taxes in the rest of the UK. Now, the reason that offers more generous funding for Scotland than the other two methods is compared to a method where you don't take account of population growth, Scotland's population grows more slowly on average than that in the rest of the UK. So if you try to compare Scotland's revenue growth to the aggregate growth in the rest of the UK, you don't take account of the population growth. Revenues per capita in Scotland have to grow more quickly to keep up because of the population growth in the rest of the UK. So by taking that into account, the PCID method is a bit more generous to Scotland. The other method we consider in our paper, we term the levels deduction method. And what that does is every year it increases the block grant adjustment by the population share of the change in revenues in the rest of the UK. Now, that method we chose to examine because that kind of mirrors the Barnett formula, which allocates the population share of the change in spending in the rest of the UK. Now, the reason that one's less generous to Scotland than the PCID method is that revenues per capita in Scotland start off lower. So, for instance, in England, say revenues go up by 10 billion, that might be, say, a 7% increase in revenues in England. Scotland's population share of that 10 billion, it's about 10%, £1 billion. But £1 billion growth in Scotland wouldn't be 7% growth, it'd be more like 9% growth because revenues start off lower in Scotland. So under the levels deduction approach, you need revenues in Scotland to grow more quickly in percentage terms to keep up with the block grant adjustment, which is going up in a kind of cash terms basis. So the method which gives the kind of most generous funding to Scotland under current kind of conditions with relatively slower population growth and lower revenues per capita to start with is the per capita indexation deduction. Now then there's the question about what is fair or not, and that depends on what you think the degree of risk sharing and equalisation should be across the UK. If you think that the no detriment principle means that you wouldn't want to design a system which would lead to the unwinding of any redistribution that currently exists between Scotland and the rest of the UK, you'd want to choose a system which kind of keeps that level of redistribution built in. And that might mean that if revenues go up by the same percentage points per capita, so revenues grow 5% per person in England, 5% per person in Scotland, you might think that in that case, Scottish budget should be the same as it would have been without devolution, because revenue is growing at the same rate per person, Scotland's performing as well as the rest of the UK, they should be unaffected. You'd want to choose PCID. If, on the other hand, you thought the devolution of a tax meant it's no longer right to redistribute that tax across the whole of the UK, that in future, extra tax revenues raised in England shouldn't be partially transferred to Scotland, you'd want to choose the levels deduction approach, because that approach means that revenues raised in England stay in England, and revenues raised in Scotland stay in Scotland. The per capita indexation approach, the PCID approach, means that there'd be some transfer of revenues from England in future years to Scotland. So it's clear what's better for Scotland in terms of the amount of budget, but what's fair depends on your view on should there be continuing redistribution of income tax around the UK.
Could I come on this, in on this? The committee has got on its website evidence of modelling by David Iser from Stirling and Anton Muscatelli from Glasgow. It's pretty obvious from that modelling that it's a per capita indexation method that actually meets the idea that the act of devolving tax powers is not going to be disadvantageous to Scotland. So I support the per capita indexation method. But there's a bigger point. And that is that there is a... this is a lot of technical sounding argument about an essentially political point. If you read the Holton Commission report, and if you read the House of Lords Economic Affairs Committee, it's obvious they think that Scotland gets too much money. In terms of the political context after the Scottish referendum, the Smith Commission was supposed to do good things for Scotland. So you've got a very obvious political clash of expectations. But the point I would make is it's very important that the actual act of tax devolution does not, through the indexation method, damage the Scottish position. If you want to argue about whether Scotland's overfunded relative, for example, to Wales, you should actually argue that point explicitly. If you link through technical things that virtually nobody understands, a reduction in the Scottish budget to how the indexation works, I think you're going to discredit the tax devolution.
I think I would agree with that point as well. I do think there is a discussion to be had about the indexation method, but if the levels deduction method is being used to kind of sneak in extra convergence through the back door, I think that would be damaging to kind of the fiscal framework in the UK, and it would be a bad idea. I think if you want to deal with that issue, you need to deal with it directly.
Yes, I'd like to maybe take one step back from politics and one back towards economics for a moment and make the point that if it's the case that the PCID method does redistribute a bit more, especially over the business cycle, then this is something that the Scottish Parliament should also take into account. Right? One of the issues around devolution is a potentially lack of risk sharing across the UK. Right? If the Scottish Parliament would like to preserve some of that risk sharing, especially over the cycle, so let's imagine the oil price drops and unemployment rises here in Scotland, right? You would not want to be in a position in which you would be forced into a sort of pro-cyclical austerity politics at that moment when you're facing difficult economic conditions, right? And one of the ways in which you can guard against that is to ensure that there is still some redistributive element across the entire UK. So there's a macroeconomic stability and sort of automatic stabilizers not being pushed into austerity in bad times argument to be made as well.
Okay. David, do you want to say something else?
Add back on that last point there. All of the methods, levels deduction, index deduction, and per capita index deduction, offer that risk sharing, to at least to a degree, on shocks that affect the whole of the UK. Because revenues fall in the rest of the UK, that means the block grant reduction shrinks and that offsets any falls in Scottish tax revenues. So there is this risk insurance against shocks that hit the whole of the UK. But none of the methods that have been outlined offer any insurance against shocks that hit Scotland only. And I think that's been the missing debate in the devolution debate. The Smith Commission said what should happen to shocks that hit the whole of the UK, UK government should bear them. About gains and losses to do with policies, they should be borne by the relevant government, but not what should be who should bear the risk of shocks that hit Scotland alone or hit Scotland disproportionately, like oil price shocks or other things. And I think there needs to be a discussion about should there be some kind of way of risk sharing those shocks like the oil price shock.
We'll come on in a minute to issues to do with borrowing and how that might be used to help with these shocks and stabilisation. But first of all, before we get there, I'd just like to ask a question about that might be the Scottish position and the best position for Scotland to be in the PCID method. What do you think the Treasury's view of this is going to be?
I think it depends. It depends whether the Treasury want to keep the presence. It's the political constraints post referendum, post Smith Commission. One of the attractions for the Treasury of the Barnett mechanism was it basically avoided a lot of bilateral negotiation with Scotland, Wales and Northern Ireland about things where the Treasury didn't actually know enough to be a very effective negotiator. So basically the Treasury only has to worry about English and UK programmes, and the Barnett consequentials of that are actually automatic. The great advantage of Barnett for the devolved administrations is it keeps the Treasury off their individual budget lines. You don't have a position whereby the Treasury can say, we're going to disallow that expenditure because we disapprove of it. So, I mean, it goes back to George Younger in 1980. The expenditure switching discretion was one of the great powers of secretaries of states after 1980, formalising what had been much more informal before, and it's been one of the great powers of the Scottish Parliament. So there are advantages for the Treasury. There are bureaucratic technical advantages for Treasury for keeping the system working. But there's a bigger political issue about whether you want the United Kingdom to survive. So how you judge the success of the fiscal framework depends what you expect out of it. If the fiscal framework is seen as an attempt to bash the jocks because they had the cheek to ask for an independence referendum, or you see it as a way of getting more grievances to justify another independence referendum, very clearly the system isn't going to work. If you want the system to work, it seems to me that there are advantages in not linking indexation adjustments to the question of whether Scotland gets too much money. One of the points to make about Barnett is Barnett has a convergence property. Because of the lack of data, it's actually quite difficult to establish how far convergence has gone. The Treasury spent 25 years pretending not to understand parliamentary questions and freedom of information requests asking for comparable expenditure. And the level of ignorance is demonstrated by the fact that the House of Lords quotes identifiable expenditure as though that was solely driven by Barnett.
Monique? Yours?
No, I'm going to defer okay. on Barnett issues mainly to my colleagues, and okay. I'll speak up quite a bit about borrowing.
Okay. David, Treasury?
Yeah, so I think the Scottish Government has been clear on its position. I think, you know, Swinney has said that Scotland wants a per capita indexation deduction method. We know that the block grant adjustment issue is one of the sticking points in the negotiation. It's been highlighted in kind of the media stories about this. So I think, you know, it's likely that they are asking for different things. Now, what might be the factors that might be driving what the Treasury are thinking? One is, you know, Professor Heald has mentioned the Barnett formula and how they quite like that methodology. They might be looking for more consistency with the Barnett formula, which points you towards the levels deduction approach, which is the one that we've shown is least advantageous to Scotland in the short run. They may also be thinking about devolving the taxes in the same way as business rates have been done. So you might have noticed that the way the business rates have accounted for in the Barnett formula changed in the latest spending review period. And they basically are doing that on a levels deduction approach. So that might be indicative of where they're thinking for other taxes. I also think that what they'll be thinking about might be different. So what the Scottish Government might be more concerned about is potential long-run divergences in funding that result from the levels deduction approach, where you need to get your revenues growing quicker and quicker each year to keep up with the block grant adjustment. I think what the Treasury might be more concerned with is that under the per capita indexation method, say you increase the income tax rate in England by a percentage point to spend more on the English NHS, the way that will work through the whole system is that Scotland will get a population share of the extra funding by the Barnett formula. So revenue's got, say, £10 billion in England. Scotland gets £1 billion of that through the Barnett formula. The block adjustment goes up by, say, 7%. In Scotland, that's £800 million. So the block adjustment goes up by £800 million. And then the net effect of those two things is that Scotland's budget goes up by £200 million following a tax increase in the rest of the UK, because the PCID method doesn't quite align up with the Barnett formula. I think the Treasury would be concerned about the politics of that in England. So I don't know any privileged information about this, but I think that it's likely that, you know, the Treasury is moving towards a different system than what the Scottish Government are doing because of the differences in the incentives they face and the differences in the budgetary consequences. But I think Professor Hill is right in thinking about the long-term consequences. You know, they might be facing difficult decisions about what they think is the most fair system and what they think is the one that's most politically sustainable in the union. They might think that we want to actually go to the PCID method because we know the Scottish won't accept a disadvantageous method. So I think they're probably actually in quite a difficult position in knowing what to do as well.
I think the most important point of these discussions is the system has got to be made transparent. You cannot have a debate about fairness unless the proper data is in the public domain. I've already made the point about publication of comparable expenditure in England that drives the Scottish block and the different comparable expenditures for Wales and Northern Ireland. But as another good example, it became the Treasury practice to publish the funding policy, a new version of the funding policy document, at the time of every spending review. The Treasury just decided not to publish it at spending review 2013 and 2015. Now, it's crucial, particularly when you start a position of having devolved administrations of the UK government under different political control, it's absolutely essential that the numbers are put in the public domain at the right time. One obviously expects governments to negotiate privately, but when the deal is done, the full statistical information ought to be put immediately in the public domain and not depend on people like me putting down freedom of information requests to try to get the information months later.
Thank you very much. Mark.
Yeah, thanks, Gary. I was intrigued by the idea that the drop in oil price and resultant unemployment would be a shock that would be borne by Scotland alone within this context, given that the revenues accrue to Treasury, and there's also employment implications out with Scotland as well as a result of it. But leaving that aside, I note the command paper itself talks about the fiscal framework requiring Scotland to contribute proportionally to fiscal consolidation at the pace set out by the UK government. Now, there's been some talk here about, and Monique Ebell spoke about, not being forced into a position of austerity. But to me, that's very much the language of, you know, it's you're going to be tied into austerity by this, whether you like it or not, or at least that's the indication the UK government is giving in its command paper, is it not?
There's obviously a paradox there, because although, you know, a few minutes ago, I was talking about the convergence properties of the Barnett formula. But if you cut public spending, the Barnett formula has a divergence property, not a convergence property. But to come back to the premise of your question, one's got to recognise that it's not just oil revenues come from the oil sector. Clearly, there's very significant income tax and VAT revenues from people employed in the oil sector. So one of the points I want to make, the question about how much risk the Scottish government should take in the context of Scotland remaining part of the United Kingdom. There's a lot of talk about incentives for growth, giving governments incentives for growth. Quite a lot of that, I think, is the revolt of the rich. who don't actually who don't actually want to pay into the equalisation system anymore. The point is, the key economic levers remain with the United Kingdom government, and I think that's where most of the risk should stay.
Yes. Well, in terms of, so the point I was trying to make about, say, a shock hitting Scotland perhaps a bit unequally to the rest of the UK, was indeed about one about automatic stabilisers. So we know from looking at the way in which federations work in other countries, countries like the US and Switzerland, where they work quite well, one of the things that tends to be maintained centrally is a social security system. Right, things like welfare spending, unemployment insurance, pensions, because these are risks which should be pooled across the entire country. And leaving that as it is, leaving Social Security as a UK-wide system, offers some stability to the Scotland if it is hit by, say, a shock, say, a reduction in the oil price that leads to job losses in the oil and gas sector in the in Scotland, that the rest of the UK might not be hit by, and indeed might be benefiting from the drop in the oil price in other ways. So there's a question about exactly which types of spending you devolve and which types you leave centrally.
I think on your question there's kind of maybe two kinds of borrowing or different fiscal stances you might want to be thinking about, and maybe The statement in the command paper is focusing on one of them. The first is a shock that hits Scotland, which requires temporary borrowing. This idea that there's low revenues in Scotland because of the oil industry suffering. I would think that Scotland would need to have the capability to borrow to smooth that shock. Now, if that statement was meant to suggest that that wasn't possible, that if at that moment the UK was in a good position and was trying to not borrow, Scotland shouldn't borrow, I think that would be damaging and constraining to Scotland.
And on that, I mean, obviously the Chancellor's fiscal mandate puts him towards a position of zero borrowing, and there's a question mark around whether that is going to be implicit within the fiscal framework that Scotland would be expected to go. So essentially, Scotland would have borrowing power, but would be constrained due to the fiscal framework and the UK fiscal mandate to not be able to borrow.
But that's not quite, it's not quite clear at the present time to what extent Scotland's borrowing will count for the fiscal framework. Now, if you think about Scotland's borrowing in the same way as local authority borrowing is treated, local authority borrowing is a component, together with central government borrowing, of the government's target public sector net debt or public sector net borrowing figure, right? It is also a component of the Maastricht debt criteria, right? So currently, there's the bias, I think the institutional bias, might well be towards treating Scottish debt as if it were local, in the same way as local authority debt is currently treated. Now, it's not quite, in economic terms, there is actually a case for not considering subnational debt as part of the UK's fiscal framework, in the sense that it would, from an economic perspective, make sense to treat Scottish debt as part of the overall UK fiscal framework mandate if there were either an explicit or a strong implicit guarantee by the UK government on that debt. Right, so whether the Scottish debt should be a part of the UK's fiscal framework and the goals that the Treasury is setting for itself should depend on to what extent that debt actually is an obligation, either explicit or implicit, of the UK government.
And I guess I probably know the answer to this one, but do we have any indication, therefore, of what the Treasury thinking on that might be in terms of how they might categorise Scottish borrowing? I see shakes of the head.
That's a no. But not speaking for the Treasury, I would think it would be astonishing if the Treasury would agree to a position of not including Scottish borrowing. There's two issues. One of them is about the United Kingdom's European Union obligations under Maastricht, and in terms of the European system of accounts. Also, in terms of the United Kingdom of the IMF's Article 4 fiscal consultations on the United Kingdom. I would have thought an attempt to park it somewhere separately and pretend that it wasn't there would not work. I do not think in a country as fiscally centralised historically as the United Kingdom, people are actually going to believe whatever. If, for example, people said there was a no bailout clause, I frankly don't think anybody would believe it.
Final question.
Very brief, Mark.
Very brief. It's just simply that obviously where the line is drawn in terms of where the indexation begins is going to be important on both sides. The likelihood is probably 2017-18. In terms of where we're looking in terms of fiscal projections, is that going to be a good point for Scotland in terms of the sort of year zero for this, in your opinion?
Well, the command paper, I think, suggests you might want to use several years and average over them to get the base year for which you do the indexation. So it's not clear if, you know, they'll take just 2017-18 or they'll average over, say, 3 or 4 years before that. Whether or not that's a good period depends on if you think 2017-18 will be a year when Scottish revenues are relatively high compared to the rest of the UK or relatively low compared to the rest of the UK. If you thought, for instance, that the problems in the North Sea meant that income tax and VAT receipts were temporarily low in Scotland in 2017, you might want to lock in that and have that as your base year. And then if and when there's a recovery in the North Sea sector and that boosts revenues, Scotland gets to keep those revenues because you've kind of locked yourself in from a low starting point and you get to keep the upside. If, on the other hand, you think that actually most of the pain on the North Sea is still to come because it takes a while for the sector to wind down, then you might be kind of starting at a relatively high point and the trajectory is downwards from that point. So you're right that the starting point does matter, and that's why I come back to this point I think I made at the start, that there's not been this discussion about what degree of risk sharing there should still be on these shocks that hit Scotland disproportionately, whether they're kind of short-term shocks or the long-term secular kind of declines or improvements. Most other kind of states with kind of substantial subnational devolution have some kind of equalization of these differential trends over time. Germany has it, Canada has it, Australia. The system we're developing in the UK won't have that kind of thing, and that makes things like starting points much, much more important.
I think that as I made the argument for per capita indexation, I think that gaming the starting point would be very foolish on either the Treasury side or on the Scottish Government side. People tended to assume 18 months ago that the base year issue wouldn't be that important, but given what's happened to the oil sector, it may well be important. We also know in terms of the transition to land and building transactions tax that you can get substantial forestalling can take place. So I think that that is obviously a difficult area, and I would want to have it as neutral, to try to get a verdict which is as neutral as possible, because there are questions about the legitimacy of the system. If the system is seen to be illegitimate on either side, I frankly don't think it will survive.
Okay, we began to stray into borrowing, so I think I should go to Alison Johnson, who wanted a question on borrowing. Linda, I know you've got a supplementary, but...
No, it's all right. Okay.
Thank you, convener. I'd just be interested to hear the panel's views on the issue of borrowing. I mean, borrowing can obviously help in cases of shock, forecast errors, you know, volatility. It can also help us invest in opportunities, to build employment, infrastructure, and so on. And I'd just be interested in what you think an optimal borrowing framework would look like, what level of borrowing powers would be appropriate for this particular Scotland bill. And I believe that David Phillips, in response to Mark MacDonald's question, does think that having to contribute to UK fiscal consolidation would constrain and compromise the policy autonomy of the Parliament and Government. And I'd be interested in Dr. Ebell and Professor Heald's views on that too. Thank you.
All right. Well, on borrowing. So it's Scotland and borrowing powers is a bit of a tricky issue because it's an unusual setup. And it's very different to the setups that we see in other federated countries. Places like the US and Switzerland are perhaps the most successful and well-functioning examples, maybe along with Canada. In all of those cases, you have 26 cantons of roughly equal size, or 50 US states, or 14 Canadian provinces. Now, here we would have one quite small subnational unit and one compared to one rest of the country, and then, of course, two even smaller subnational units. Now, that presents a different set of, say, incentive problems around borrowing and around the credibility of no bailout clauses. So, indeed, borrowing can be very beneficial in order to smooth out shocks over the business cycle. It also can play a very important role in terms of accountability and setting the right incentives. So, if Scotland would like to invest in order to create jobs, promote growth, then by borrowing, it is in some sense putting its money where its mouth is and making sure that it's taking the decisions that will really lead to growth because it's going to need to pay back the money that it's borrowed, right? It's not going to be, it guards against I can be North Korean for a moment, putting up big statues to the dear leader on borrowed money, right? Now, that, of course, works only to the extent that there's not a bailout promise, or be it explicit or implicit, from the central government. Now, one of the ways I like to think about this is around my three teenagers at home. If one of them were to exceed their borrowing limit, say they go over on their mobile phone contract, they download too many videos and it gets very abroad and it gets very expensive. Now, I might be tempted to bail one of them out, but if I did, the other two would come running and say, hey, wait a minute, and it would set a very bad precedent, right? The other two would come along and start downloading irresponsibly and running up big bills as well. Now, this is close to the case that you have, say, in Swiss cantons and in the US states, where there have never been bailouts of cantons that have gone over indebted, or states that have gone over indebted. So California is sort of a perennial difficult case. The canton of Bern was in serious financial difficulties and was not bailed out. Now, in the UK, we're looking at a slightly different situation in which we would only really have the one subnational unit, potentially two, if Wales also gets similar powers, that are quite small. And that would tend to be a sort of only child problem, right? You know, you tend to be more generous with this only child that can, I really don't mean to infantilize. I mean, I hope that nobody takes this as a, I'm just realizing my example has a big pitfall that I don't intend quite explicitly, but if there's only one subnational unit that is borrowing, then the temptation to bail out might be quite a bit larger. And so I would imagine that the fiscal framework, the optimal fiscal framework, doesn't only depend on Scotland, it depends on how the rest of the UK deals with its own devolution issues, right? Whether the government is really serious about things like the Northern Powerhouse.
One of the points here is that economists tend to talk in terms of the cyclical reasons and the differential cycle reasons for wanting to have borrowing powers. And clearly, if you have more devolved tax powers, you do need more borrowing powers for smoothing purposes. But what worries me in the post-referendum situation is that people seem to think that tax powers mean more spend. They seem to think that devolving welfare powers mean more welfare spend. And I'm sure that the argument will arise that people will want to use borrowing powers to offset the UK government's austerity agenda. When I first proposed what became the Tartan tax in 1976, one was assuming there wasn't that much difference between what a devolved administration in Scotland, Wales and Northern Ireland would want to do and what the UK government would want to do. When you get a UK agenda about shrinking the state, which is not shared by the other, by the devolved administrations, you get a big gulf. You cannot, it would be difficult to use tax powers to offset the shrink the state agenda. Any notion that you can use borrowing to offset the shrink the state agenda is an extremely dangerous one. So I think one has to be, I think the idea that there can be no control on borrowing is fallacious. I think there has to be control. There have to be controls on borrowing. Quite what the mechanisms are, I'm more open-minded. But there's no way that either internally I would favour it or in terms of the UK's international obligations.
Yes, if I may add a couple of points. I think in terms of the level of borrowing powers, they will have to be substantially increased, especially on the current borrowing side. At the moment, the current borrowing powers are really quite constrained. Scotland can only use them for forecast errors. But if you forecast a recession, you might still want to borrow to kind of smooth the impact of that on your public spending. So I think there will need to be a change in the level and the type of circumstances in which those borrowing powers can be used. My colleagues, David Bell, David Iser and I, are going to be doing a paper which will try to quantify how big those borrowing powers need to be given the potential volatility and risk in the Scottish budget with all these new powers. So we'll try to get a number for you guys about kind of, you know, will 5 billion be enough? Will 3 billion? Will 10 billion be enough on these powers? I think then is the question, you know, will the UK government also be willing to not only allow Scotland's borrowing powers to smooth the cycle in effect, but also to pursue longer term differential fiscal stance? So, you know, rather than surplus in normal times, the Scottish government saying we want to borrow 1% of GDP in normal times because we think that is actually sustainable. I think there's less chance the UK government acquiescing to that because that will be seen as, you know, not just kind of giving Scotland the powers to manage its risks, but also allowing it to, in effect, take long-term fiscal, a longer-term fiscal stance that's different to the UK, with the implicit backstop of the UK kind of being there to bail out. So I think whether or not there'll be what the UK government will agree to do on borrowing powers might depend to the extent to which the kind of idea of no bailout being seems credible or not. Then I think on the capital side, that's a whole other issue. There's been the debate about whether that should be kind of some kind of extended capital limit or whether it should be prudential borrowing powers. I'm not sure what I think is the right answer there, but I think that what's often been said in that area is that this system has worked very well for local government, where they have prudential borrowing powers. I think that is the case for local government. I'd say it's not clear that necessarily be the case for the Scottish government, given that there's quite different political issues involved there, issues around bailout and issues around central government retaking control if they think there's been imprudential borrowing. So again, I think there is, you know, actually a good case to say that the Scottish government should have these prudential borrowing powers, but I could also hear the Treasury saying that, you know, we think we can override the powers by a local government if it turns out to go badly. There's no way we can do that with Scotland, and therefore they'll be more reluctant to grant those powers than otherwise.
Well, I guess the way that I would think about this would again come back to the credibility of the no bailout clause. Right? If it's possible for, and that's a big if, for the Treasury to credibly commit to not bailing out, then we know from the experience of other countries that countries with credible no bailout promises, in those countries, actually the market mechanisms work very well, in the sense that if a subnational unit, if a Swiss canton or a US state overborrows, then it will find itself punished with higher interest rates, right? So in that sense, that mechanism works well, and in fact it works so well that many Swiss cantons and the majority of US states have self-imposed fiscal rules on themselves, either of a sort of balanced budget, over the cycle kind of constraint, or a golden rule, you know, some sort of net fiscal balance, but setting aside investment, right? So in that sense, the market does, when there's a credible bailout promise or no bailout promise, then the market mechanism works well. And in fact, it works so well that subnational units find it to their advantage to signal to the market that they are prudent by self-imposing a fiscal rule of some sort. Now, the big open question is, will it be possible to set up such a credible no bailout framework?
Yeah. You happy, Alison?
Yes, thank
Stuart, you. I knew you were interested in borrowing. Do you want to come in just now, or do you want to? Have you got enough from that?
No, just I'll come from that, if it's okay. It's much. I've heard quite a lot, and certainly Alison posed a couple of the questions I was considering. But the thing that struck me in terms of the answers, Dr. Ebell, you used the phrase of federated countries. Now, the UK is not a federated country, and irrespective as to the additional powers that are to come to here, the UK is still not a federated country. And also with the four different nations within the UK, there are various levels of devolution, because also the devolution agreements are not standardised across the four nations. And it's also touched upon in terms of the Northern Powerhouse agenda, and also how that might also have a positive effect upon also the north of England. But there's still also question marks in terms of the levels of powers that will go along with that. So I did listen to everything that was said, but at the same time, I'm a bit confused in terms of the starting point from yourselves in terms of the level of powers and the position, the constitutional position within the four nations.
Well, you know, as I said at the outset, this is a tricky discussion simply because it is an atypical case, right? Usually, countries with subnational units that have the kind of revenue raising and expenditure powers that Scotland is set to receive are one of many similar units in a federated country. The only other country that I can think of, or the main country I can think of, that has a similar sort of asymmetric devolution framework is Spain. And I'm not sure that given the recent difficulties, especially around subnational borrowing in Spain, that we would want to take their framework as any sort of a guide.
But the US, with the different states there, they're all different shapes and sizes and populations as well.
They are, but there are many of them, mm-hmm. right? And each one is small relative to the whole. And the federal government also understands that it is facing many, many states. It is facing potentially 50 states. So if it gives in to one, then the others are likely to there's a risk that they would come calling as well. That risk really doesn't exist in the same way in the UK, and that is important. What we do also understand, and what is from federated countries, is that those federated countries in which the revenue raising and the expenditure powers are closely matched, that is, those countries in which the subnational units, the cantons or the states, do not rely mainly on transfers, but mainly rely on their own ability to raise taxes and their own ability to borrow, they tend to perform better. Right? There's a nice IMF, International Monetary Fund study out recently, that shows that those federations in which revenue raising powers and expenditures are matched closely with low dependence on transfers, those tend to perform better. That's the US, Canada, and Switzerland primarily. One reason for that, again, I'm sorry to harp on the point of credibility, may be that by having a small transfer dependence, that actually makes the no bailout clause more credible. Right. So again, if my teenager overspends, but I can say, well, look, you can do some babysitting, yeah, or you can use your overdraft, then I'm also much more able to say no to bailing out. So I think that's an important point here.
Could I come back to the premise of your question? My view is the United Kingdom is very dysfunctional. I think that if you look at where the big hits on fiscal consolidation at the UK level has gone, that they've gone heavily to local government in England, and there's been a massive removal of redistribution within the local government finance system within England. And if you look at the hits that the northern and Midlands industrial cities have had, you will see the extent of that. And I think the northern powerhouse, I think, is largely a political cover for the damage which has actually been done within England. The London and the South East is so dominant within the United Kingdom, increasingly dominant. It is the net recipient of much of the immigration into the UK, meaning that the population trend factor has become more important. And the rest of the United Kingdom has been writing implicit guarantees to the financial sector. If you do a thought experiment about what the regional impact would have been of the United Kingdom letting the banking and financial sector collapse in 2008, very clearly there would have been massive hits for London and the South East. The actual fiscal repair from that damage has actually largely hit other parts of the United Kingdom, particularly the North of Midlands. One of the things that really worries me, and I think it's a fundamental point for this Parliament, is that given the strange animal, asymmetric animal, that United Kingdom is, there's a natural alliance between Scotland, Wales and Northern Ireland in terms of having some kind of agreed position in relation to the UK government, the Treasury. One of the things is that the last 10 years we've actually lost Wales, and Wales is often associated with attacks on the Scottish position. And I think that is partly attributable to the fact the Labour government did not, at the UK level, did not actually make an effort to sustain the Barnett system. In 2002, Alistair MacLeod and I published an Institute for Public Policy Research book chapter in which we explained, you know, what the then problems with Barnett were, what could actually be done to assuage fears in Wales and Northern Ireland about it. But nothing was done. There was plenty of money around, and people didn't worry very much about it. And one's now seeing the consequences. But you can't discuss Scotland without thinking about the broader context of the UK's regional dysfunctionality.
We'll need to move on. I'll move to Malcolm Chisholm and areas to do with welfare, which I've picked up, I think, by somebody in the last set of questions.
Yeah, I think most of the discussion of the block grant adjustment has been in relation to taxpayers, particularly income tax, but obviously there are completely different issues with welfare. So I'd welcome your thoughts on, I suppose, the initial allocation of money to welfare, which may not be quite so controversial, but the block grant adjustment thereafter, and to what extent that's complicated or made different by the fact that welfare is under AMI, annually managed expenditure, rather than the DEL expenditure that we're used to.
I think that having it under AMI as opposed to DEL makes it somewhat easier, actually. In terms, you can kind of think of tax as being like AMI as well. You don't know what you're going to spend tax is like AMI in the same way as wealth is like AMI. You don't know what you're going to raise or you're going to spend in a particular year until you have it. It's not like a DEL where it's fixed in advance. So I don't think there's any particular issues with welfare being AMI in terms of the block grant additions and how you index those, because you have the same issues with taxation. In terms of, do you want to have a separate or more complicated way of indexing those block grant additions for welfare than you do on tax? I'm not entirely convinced by that. So, you know, in tax, people are focused on, you know, two or three relatively simple methods, whether it's the per capita indexation method or whether it's the levels deduction method. On welfare, there's sometimes been discussions about, well, welfare is not just about population, it's about the characteristics of the population, particularly with disability benefits. It's about the kind of population at risk, the older and the less healthy population. And we should have an indexation measure which accounts for those. Now, in principle, I think, you know, that does seem plausible, but I think in practice it could be difficult, and it might be therefore more transparent and simpler to go with a more basic approach like per capita indexation. And the reason being this. First of all, you could think about making an adjustment in the first year and then saying, OK, we know what the distribution of disability benefit spending is across ages in year one, and we can then track the population over time by these age groups and adjust on that basis. But there's been very big shifts in how disability benefits are spent over different age groups. In the last, 20 years, there's been big falls amongst older people and increases amongst younger people. And if you don't account for that, you get these you get allocations which don't actually reflect who requires disability benefit spending. And if you do try to account for that, you have a very complicated system where you're changing the indexation method every year, requires constant renegotiation and violates one of the other principles of the Smith Commission. I also think if you take into account not only age, but also, say, the health of the population, you're removing one of the main incentive effects, one of the main benefits that has been discussed about this. So when devolution of disability benefits has been discussed in the past, it's sometimes been about, well, now we can integrate these better with our healthcare and social care services, and if we do better on healthcare and social care, and that means less ill health, we get to reap the rewards and lower benefits spending and have more to spend, and you can shift that money over to other areas of priority. And if you adjust for these health trends, you remove that benefit of devolving the powers, because health improves in Scotland, you give less money to Scotland for welfare because the population is now more healthy. You don't want to be kind of removing those incentive effects, I think. So my feeling would be stick with something more simple like the methods that are being discussed for tax. It'll do a reasonably good job. You might in principle be able to do a bit better with other methods, but there are trade-offs in terms of complexity or in terms of removing incentives.
I would tend to agree with David that incentives are important, but I would maybe take a slightly more nuanced view. And I will, again, use an example from abroad. And so maybe you're familiar with Detroit. Detroit has recently filed for bankruptcy. And the main reason for that is that Detroit found itself in a secular decline along with the auto industry. It found that it had quite a large number of pensioners with the incumbent, of course, pension costs and healthcare costs that were locally financed. Now, it found itself with rising costs for pensions and healthcare and a shrinking tax base. And this put Detroit into quite a downward spiral, right? The difficulty was that they had to increase property tax rates, the main local source of revenue, further and further in order to finance the pensions from its shrinking tax base. Now, by increasing those rates, Detroit made itself even less attractive to business and actually accelerated the process of decline, right, until it crashed into a wall. Now, I, again, sincerely hope that this is not a scenario that is relevant for Scotland, but it is one to have in the back of one's mind, at least not in this extreme case. But it maybe does highlight that there are some kinds of welfare spending where incentives are more important, say, disability benefits, even unemployment insurance. But there are other kinds, say, pensions, where it's more difficult to see how there is much that the Scottish government can do to change the number of pensioners. Right? So in some sense, you might want to treat these different kinds of welfare spending differently. And in particular, I would think that pensions are a good you would want to adjust for the age structure when looking at the welfare benefits, welfare grants.
One of the things I worry about is Barnett was essentially a simple system. Over time, it's already become more complicated in terms of the split between resource del, capital del, financial transactions, transactions capital, rules about EYF and rules about budget exchange. So I think that keeping the system as simple as possible to maintain a degree of intelligibility on the basis of much better published information is an extremely important point. On the welfare side, what essentially worries me about welfare is the numbers can be very big. And what worries me is that people who don't know enough about the actual costings and the numbers will actually promise to offset by Scottish Government action changes by the UK Government. As soon as you start getting the idea that welfare devolution means more spend and you're going to offset austerity imposed at the UK level, I think becomes extremely dangerous. If people want the welfare system in Scotland to be more generous, fine, but I wish they'd tell me which main programmes like health and education are going to be cut to fund it and which taxes are going to be increased to pay for it.
Welcome.
No, that was extremely helpful and useful. So I suppose, I mean, well, given David Phillips in particular nailed his colours to the mast there, what are the risks of that? I mean, potentially, I mean, you've done the risks for the different income tax scenarios. I suppose it's just a bit worrying if we do have, well, we're not getting pensions, but obviously some of the benefits might be more skewed towards older people. So are there potential risks there with a higher proportion of the population perhaps being elderly?
I would agree very much with what Monica Ebell was saying there in terms of you've got to think about the risks and rewards with each of the different benefits. Now, I think, as Monica said, that with disability benefits, it's more towards the rewards because of the links with health and social care policy and the potential to make a real difference there by integrating the two. But of course, yeah, there are risks. So for instance, if the somewhat more rapid ageing of the population in Scotland was to lead to disability benefit spending per capita to grow more quickly than in the rest of the UK, if we only did a per capita indexation, Scotland would find itself worse off. On the other hand, the big trend actually we've seen over the last 15 years is that disability benefit spending per capita in Scotland has been falling very substantially compared to the rest of the UK. And that's because the trends driving it, in the 1980s, the big growth in disability benefits was to do with deindustrialisation. There were huge numbers of older male workers, effectively, that got shifted onto disability benefits. That affected mainly Scotland, Wales, north of England. As that has started to shift off and more of the disability benefit burden has moved on to things like mental health and other issues which affect people more across the country, welfare spending has been going down in places like Scotland and Wales and going up in places like the southeast of England. Now, if that trend was to continue, and it looks like there is still some scope for that, it's been continuing over the last few years, you might see that Scottish revenues still continue to fall Scottish spending on disability benefits continues to fall per person, and that means Scotland actually would still potentially gain under this system. So I think there's potential for risk and reward under the devolution of welfare benefits, and of course the potential to design a different system that could better suit Scotland or better suit Scottish Government policy aims.
Okay, thank you, that's very helpful.
I just one new question around that. I mean, whatever the drivers might be in the economy, if the welfare bill for Scottish Parliament and Scottish Government in the future was to increase, and I think somebody made the point that we need to make some tough decisions, either reducing expenditure in other areas or indeed potentially raising tax. And the issue of how much we could raise by taxation is something I've been interested in. And I just wondered, if we were to apply, say, a 1p increase only to the higher rate of income tax, what would that give us in terms of income?
I'm not entirely sure on the numbers there. I think the best people to ask would be Spice, because they have a model which allows you to simulate the impact of different changes in tax rates. And I can see they're over there. Okay, so well, I think they're the best people to ask.
We shall look to that, a bit of information. Okay, thank you. Linda, you had some interest in welfare area. You want to come in just now, or I go to Stuart on detriment?
You just did it, convener.
I'm sorry.
That's quite all right. No, right. Please just move on to Stuart.
Sure, Maxwell.
Thank you, convener. I want to ask a couple of questions about the no detriment principle, or effectively the two no detriment principles. The one, roughly speaking, the one that's based at devolution, and then the one based about no detriment from decisions post the actual devolution of powers. In practice, how do you see it working in terms of the Scottish and UK governments? How would they determine what incurs a payment under the second no detriment principle? I mean, what rules would you see in force that would actually result in a payment taking place from a change in policy post the devolution of the powers, so the actual changes in the use of the powers once they're devolved?
I think the first no detriment principle I covered actually before, the idea that one doesn't, the actual act of devolution of tax doesn't actually affect Scotland's relative position, whatever the arguments about that position are. I think the kind of second no detriment principle is largely incoherent. I think that one of the historical backgrounds for it, I suspect, was the big argument in the early days of devolution about the Treasury refusing to let the Scottish Parliament have the savings from attendance allowance when the Scottish Government introduced free personal care. I think that there are areas where one has got to be very careful, and if you want this system to work on a very asymmetric basis with some welfare expenditure devolved. One of the things that's going to cause difficulty is if the Scottish income tax system departs from the rest of UK income tax system, it's going to have an interaction with the benefit system. And I think the idea of payments flowing backwards and forwards across the border is actually implausible. I think it will be extremely fractious. I think the question of modelling what those numbers should be, it will create lots of jobs for the big accountancy firms to produce rival estimates. I don't think that's a productive thing. I think one of the kind of worries is about the border area, and in terms of airport passenger duty, I sometimes see arguments that sound like wanting to put Newcastle Airport out of business, and things which are clearly targeted and actually create resentment at either side of the border are things which, if you want the system to work, they should be avoided. So I think any kind of detailed passing and forward of compensation payments is a recipe for disaster. I think it depends upon the degree of cooperation between the governments thinking about issues like, for example, the interaction of the tax system and the benefit system. One of the things we don't have is as good a data. For example, the HMRC surveys are done for HMRC purposes. With regional tax devolution and some regional welfare devolution, it becomes much more important to have better data, and that probably means that bigger surveys at the UK level.
Yes, David. I agree largely with much of that, although I'm not sure I'd go quite as far as saying that I don't think these transfers should be made in any circumstances. So I think that, you know, Professor Hill is right that working out what the transfers you might want to make in a given policy change will be extremely complicated. It'll be prone to disagreement because different assumptions are made about behavioural responses, about labour supply effects, about consumption effects. You know, the example I often give is around the 50p tax rate. If Scotland wants to increase the tax rate to 50p on the top incomes again, there could be several different kinds of knock-on effects on revenues in the rest of the UK. One, people might work less, which means less national insurance as well, which would hit the Treasury. And should the Scottish Government compensate the Treasury for those losses in national insurance? People might also shift their income from labour income into dividends income, because the 45p rate would still apply to that. That means an increase in the revenues to the Treasury. Should the Treasury pay some of those back to Scotland? What if people move to England to avoid the tax? Should the Treasury pay back those revenues? And you can imagine the kind of complexity around trying to work out all these different effects and the scope for argument. So I think, as a general principle, it should be avoided trying to work these compensation payments. But I do think there may be circumstances where you can work out some first round effects of these policies. And I think maybe that should be a kind of a principle to have in mind, that where there's a direct impact of a policy change on a tax or a benefit or spending item in the rest of the UK, and you can clearly work out the first round effects of that, then maybe that's maybe where you might consider it. So the example given, you know, in the previous kind of days, the attendance allowance and the free personal care, there would have been the potential to work out a first-round effect of that. Another one would be with the interaction between universal credit and income tax. Scottish Government cuts income tax, people's net income increases. Ignoring any behavioural effects of that, you can work out what that means in terms of less universal credit being paid by the UK Government. And the UK government transfer those savings to Scotland. So I think if it's direct and if it's first round effects only, it can sometimes be done. But as a general principle, to be used in every time there's a knock-on effect, completely unworkable and scope for disagreement all over the place.
Monique, do you want to contribute to that bit?
I guess as I want to do, I'm going to again look abroad. And I'm really not aware, although many of the federations that have been successful in the long term do have some sort of equalization mechanism, I'm really not aware of any federation that has a sort of no detriment principle. And I would imagine that David is right, that the first round effects are possibly workable, but that if you really try to do this carefully, then it's going to become a mess. And there are probably good reasons that these sorts of no detriment principles generally have not been applied in other places.
One of the points I would make as a condition for ever making no detriment payments is it symmetric? If the Scottish government does it and benefits the UK government, does the UK government have to pay and vice versa? An asymmetric one whereby the Scottish government had to pay the UK government, but the UK government didn't have to pay the Scottish government, strikes me as something to be avoided.
Stuart, anything else?
No, I think that's it.
Okay, Rob Gibson.
Looking at the idea of information analysis and transparency in all of this, a good fiscal framework needs sound financial reporting. And obviously the Fiscal Commission in Scotland has been proposed as the mechanism for doing our forecasting, as the OBR does it in London. So what needs to be done to improve fiscal reporting in Scotland so that the Parliament can monitor what's going on? And secondly, who should be the arbiter if the OBR and the Scottish Fiscal Commission don't agree?
So I think in terms of what's needed in terms of public information to ensure that this is transparent and ensure that the government's held to account, I think it's not only Scottish fiscal forecasts. I think there needs to be a proper public document laid before both parliaments which sets out how the block grant has been calculated each year, a full working of the Barnett formula, not just kind of the resulting totals, but actually line by line how the budget, the Barnett block grant was worked out, and then line by line how the block grant adjustment was made and the assumptions that underlie that, so that people understand, yes, we're forecasting revenue growth of this, revenue growth of that. And then subsequently, documents published that show the reconciliation of those with the actual outturns for revenues in the rest of the UK. So I think it's more than just kind of better forecast for Scotland. It's better information on how the actual fiscal framework is operating year to year. In terms of if there's disagreements between the OBR and the Scottish Fiscal Commission, I think I would this time point to what happens overseas. So if you look in Australia, there's something called the Commonwealth Grants Commission, which makes recommendations on how the grants should be set and based on evidence it takes from the states and from the federal government. It makes a recommendation, and usually the recommendation is acted upon by the federal government. But ultimately, it's the federal government that makes the decision in the end. Now, there's the question of, would such an approach be seen as acceptable in the UK, that you have these two reports, they differ somewhat, ultimately the federal, the UK, the central government makes the decision, or would it be some form of political negotiation between the two? We saw with the devolution of stamp duty that there were big differences in the OBR verified forecasts and the Fiscal Commission forecast from Scotland on revenues. In the end, there was a negotiation between the two finance ministers, and they split the difference in the middle. Not ideal, but I think these are political issues, and I think whilst the technocrat in me would like to see some kind of external kind of arbiter that can kind of impose a judgment on it, I don't think that's feasible, and I think it'll ultimately come down to politics, and it'll be the politicians that make the decision.
I, th- I, think it has to be a political negotiation, but it needs to be a political negotiation on the basis of institutions that have the expertise and the information made transparent so that other people can actually see what has happened.
I guess I would add to that that one mechanism, one potential mechanism for reducing conflict is to introduce some sort of ex post compensation to the party that turned out to have been, say, correct or misjudged. So say the OBR and the Fiscal Commission were to have disagreed, that had an impact, have disagreed on their forecast, that had an impact on, say, a spending allocation or a block grant. Now, if those forecasts, say we used the OBR forecast, if that forecast turned out to be wrong and that turned out to be to the detriment of Scotland, you could think about some sort of ex post compensation, writing that into a rule, right? Or it could have gone the other way, right? Say the OBR was wrong, that turned out to be the benefit of Scotland, right? The flip side of that would be you might have to accept an ex post adjustment. But I think there could be a positive incentive effect of such, just the threat of such an ex post adjustment, in the sense that that would reduce the incentives for either side to game their forecasts, right? If you know that ultimately what matters is the outcome, then you're going to try to give your best forecast, and any disagreement will then really be a sort of reasonable people can disagree about this kind of outcome.
I think that is correct. And I think the plan is that there will be these reconciliations in subsequent years. So the plan, as I understand it, is that there will be an initial adjustment to the block grant made just before the fiscal year starts. Then, when the outturn data comes in, so the adjustment is forecast in year T minus one for year T. When the outcome data comes in year T plus one, you then readjust, and there's some kind of offsetting mechanism there. So I think that the method that Monique Ebell mentioned is what is in the plan. I think that will actually, as she says, given that ultimately what matters is the outturn rather than the forecasts, that will mean that each side has an incentive to give their best forecast because they know at some point in future that it'll be the outcome that matters rather than the forecast.
David, quickly, and then I'm going to come to Tavish. If you've got anything to add.
Yeah, I think, I mean, I'm in favour of independent fiscal institutions, but I think one has to be careful. I think that the independent fiscal institutions operate in a fact that we don't actually know what's going to happen in the economy, and there can be very, very big uncertainties. And what we saw at the time, of the autumn statement, the Chancellor suddenly found an extra 27 billion. Now, if there hadn't been an independent OBR, the Treasury would not have dared to claim there was an extra 27 billion because we'd have all laughed at them. So the independent fiscal institutions are part of the political game themselves and facing a situation of big uncertainty. And I think that kind of, I read in the newspaper that OBR provided five successive numbers for the Treasury. Now, unsurprisingly, the Treasury chose the best one for its purposes.
Tavish.
So are you arguing, therefore, that all these so-called independent bodies aren't independent at all? They're just gaming every bit as bad as government does?
No, I wasn't saying that at all. I think that they are operating they are technocrats operating in a framework of lots of uncertainty about what's going to happen in the world. Things can change as the world changes and as the most recent data change, but the politicians will gain them. And that, you know, the political judgment of the Treasury in the context of the autumn statement would not to have been gone to Andrew Tyrie in the Treasury Committee and say, we've suddenly, after all this trouble about tax credits, we've suddenly found an extra 27 billion, because Andrew Tyrie would have laughed at them.
I totally buy that, but I'm more interested in the principle of how we move forward, and I don't understand how. If all forecasting is to be independent, of course, at the moment we haven't got that in the Scottish Fiscal Commission. Some of the forecasting the government have yet to agree should be completely independent. I hope they'll agree to that. But if this gaming is to go on, then the game's all political all the time, isn't it? I mean, I thought we had independent forecasters because they gave an independent forecast and that was that. I don't actually understand this whole point about needing I can't remember your exact phrase, Dr. Ebell, about some mechanism to get it right afterwards. I can't see how that could work in a practical sense.
Well, if what I'm saying is that if you make sure that what matters ultimately is the outcome rather than the forecast, that then gives the right incentives to your body, however independent or even not independent it is, to get it right. Yeah, and that's ultimately what you want, right? Independence is always a bit relative, right? You know, we know that people in who are members of independent commissions might have their own political leanings or not. So I think that just making sure that outturns matter.
If we don't get it right at the start and we don't have confidence, by which I mean academics, parliament, I don't really mean government, I mean academics, parliament, people watching this process, if they don't have confidence in the Fiscal Commission or for that matter the OBR at the start, then this game's impossible. Well, there has to be complete confidence that these institutions are independently assessing the numbers given to them and are coming up with their best valued judgment of what those numbers should be, right?
But economists have different views about how the world works. There is also the problem of when data becomes available. Yeah. There is a sense in which, you know, rather than everybody criticising the Treasury for forecasts, people now criticise the OBR for the forecast. So there's a considerable element of blame avoidance and blame shifting going on. I mean, there is obviously a potential difficulty if there's a conflict between the Scottish Fiscal Commission and the OBR. Mm. One of the points I would make is that New Zealand has actually attracted considerable criticism from the IMF in the context of Article 4 consultations about not having, as far as I know, still doesn't have an independent fiscal commission. But one of the points that the New Zealand Treasury has made to me is, first of all, they've got a very good record in terms of fiscal forecasting. And secondly, in a small country context, you have to be worried about the dispersal of expertise. And I think that's an issue for Scotland as well. I mean, unless you're willing to put very significant resources into expertise, you're not necessarily going to improve the position.
Yes, well, I just wanted to underline the point that among economists, you know, all among economists, independent economists with the best of intentions, we do tend to disagree with each other. And there are many issues about which reasonable economists can disagree. That's it.
Good point.
Do it.
I was going to give quite a simple numerical example to explain why this outcomes versus forecasts kind of gives the right incentives to the two fiscal commissions not to try to game the system, to try to give the independent, honest forecasts. So let's say that you're going to be devolving income tax to Scotland and you ask the two fiscal commissions to estimate what you think those revenues should be, how much you should take off the block grant, and the Scottish Fiscal Commission says we think it's going to be 10 billion, the UK OBR says it's going to be 11 billion. And then the government's trying to negotiate, you know, some compromise, and they say 10.5 billion. Now, it turns out, actually, it's 10.7 billion pounds is raised in that income tax in that first year, and the method you've got says that, you know, you should then take 10.7 billion pounds off the block grant. So what you initially take off is that 10.5, say, the fudge they've come up with, and then 2 years down the line, when you work out what the real number is, you say, well, actually, no, we were a bit wrong there. We're going to take a further 200 million off, so it matches that 10.7 billion. Now, whether the OBR had said 12 billion and the Fiscal Commission had said 9 billion or any other number, you would still come to that 10.7 billion number in the end. So because they know what they forecast, ultimately it doesn't matter. They have no incentive to try to game the forecasts because they know the outturn is what matters. Actually, they have an incentive to get the forecast as good as possible for their own credibility. So I think that's why making it outcomes related helps give you this the independence and the credibility of the forecast. I think that's the point.
Your argument, David Phillips, is that those outcomes should be reported to Parliament on an annual basis as part of what, the budgetary process?
Yep, and then you make an adjustment to the block grant adjustment once those outcomes come in.
That's very good.
Tavish, happy with that? That's fine. I'm going to leave the last question to Linda, quickly on VAT, because we haven't covered that.
Right. Now, it seems to me that everything we've covered today sounds very complicated and
packed full of risk for Scotland. So for the last question, can I ask, is it less complicated and less of a risk when we look at the assignation of VAT in terms of the initial mechanism and the ongoing?
I think that one of the issues arose that at the time of the Smith Commission, one wanted to devolve as much as possible. And so assignment of VAT got into that into that picture. I think there are significant risks about VAT and many of the same indexation issues arise. But the point I want to make is Angus Armstrong and Monique have got a paper in National Institute Economic Review in which they talk about the Scottish Parliament being one of the most powerful devolved parliaments in the world, and the numbers they use is control of 65% of spend and 45% of revenue. Now, I don't accept that description. Because, frankly, I don't think it matters what proportion of revenue the Scottish Parliament notionally raises. I think the key question is whether you actually have any credible varying powers. So one of the big differences between the US states and US states, Canadian provinces and Swiss cantons is they have a credible tax varying capacity. Now, I wrote an article in 1997 having been very much a Tartan tax supporter. I actually wrote a paper saying I worried about the potential atrophying of the system. And my big worry going forward is that after all these debates, all the political controversy, all the legislative process, we may get ourselves in a position whereby the tax powers are not usable. So what matters is the usability of the tax powers. Now, clearly the UK government's got responsibility, because I've already made a point to the committee before that the Scottish Parliament has got to notify HMRC by the 30th of November what its Scottish income tax rates are going to be, bans and rates are going to be. The Chancellor has till March to potentially sabotage that arrangement. If the UK government starts doing that, it will totally destabilise the system. And I think that it was unfortunate that the Tartan tax atrophied, but I think that we would all agree the stakes are much higher now.
So I would like to respond to that briefly, because I think that was a somewhat misleading representation of my views on Angus's...
Monique, I'll allow you to respond briefly, but I don't want to get into a debate about...
No, I don't intend to. I do want to stick to VAT and rate-setting powers, and of course it's crucially important, right? The ability to set rates is important for incentives and is an important measure of fiscal autonomy for a subnational government. Now, there's a good reason. Looking abroad, there's a good reason that VAT revenues are not often shared, and when a VAT-like tax is delegated to a subnational unit, it is usually not a VAT, but a sales tax. So we know that from, say, the US and Canada, they impose retail sales taxes. The distinction is you do not need to follow the entire chain of value added and disentangle where was value added at each step along the process. All that matters is where is the final point of sale. And that is a much easier way to disentangle. Now, I'm afraid that it's rather unlikely that the rest of the UK will agree to shift to a sales tax, because that would make devolution easier, but it would. And it would also, of course, that kind of devolution would involve real rate-setting powers, right? That would allow Scotland to set its own rate of sales tax, which might well be different from that in the rest of other parts of the UK.
It would also be inconsistent with the UK's membership of the European Union.
Yes. Yeah.
David, very quickly.
Well, that's up for grabs too, isn't it?
David, quickly.
I was going to echo a lot of what Monique was saying. In terms of actually the way this is devolved and actually calculating the adjustments, working out Scotland's share of VAT, I think it is incredibly complicated. If you look at the way that the estimates are kind of calculated for jurors and the HMRC ones, they're not based on any real VAT data. They're based on estimates and household surveys and national accounts and gross value added and public sector accounts. It's not an actual measure of the tax revenues. It's a pure estimate. The estimate also jumps up and down quite a bit because of the sampling error in the surveys, and I don't think that's going to be appropriate for this tax. The only way I can see you working is, one, an impossible move to a sales tax, or two, a difficult move to separate accounting, which has been discussed in the context of corporation tax in Northern Ireland. Might that also be required for VAT in Scotland, where you ask companies to account for kind of transactions across the Scottish, UK, Scottish-English border, which becomes quite complicated and actually starts to undermine the single market of the UK. Yeah. So I think that is very complicated. In terms of whether or not there's any benefit of the assignment or not, I'm not quite as negative. I do think that even if there's no power to vary the rate, actually having an assignation of something can still provide some incentives. The UK government has a policy in England on assigning business rates revenues to the councils, at least partially, so they have incentives to grow it. The Scottish government has the business rates incentivisation scheme, where they can't change business rates, but councils get to keep a proportion of the growth in business rates, the idea being that that gives them more incentive. So I think there is some incentive, even if it's assignation, but clearly it's a lot of complexity for less incentive and less autonomy than you get with full devolution and full rate varying powers.
Okay, I'm afraid we're going to have to conclude today's witness session at this stage. But can I thank you all for a very helpful session, I think, across a range of areas, which is very helpful. Now, obviously, we'll either have or will not have a fiscal agreement at some stage, but if we do have a fiscal agreement, I would welcome any views that you have at that time to put to the committee in writing at that stage about what your views would be. It would be very helpful. But that brings this particular evidence session to an end, and we now move into private, so thank you. No, sorry, we're not going to private, another item yet before we go into private, so forgive me, we've got item number two, which I'm going to go straight into, and that's the correspondence from the Scottish Government on intergovernmental relations. Stephen, I'm going to hand over to you quickly on that.
Just briefly, Convener, just to inform members, obviously the committee will recall that in its recent report on intergovernmental relations, one of your recommendations, specifically recommendation number three, was that there should be a new written agreement on parliamentary oversight of intergovernmental relations drawn up between the Scottish Government and the Scottish Parliament. Mr. Swinney has written to the committee on the 15th of December, indicating his support in principle for a written agreement and offering his officials to have some initial discussions with parliamentary officials on that. So with the committee's approval, I would be happy to take forward those initial discussions with Scottish Government officials to produce perhaps some drafts and bring those back to the committee formally to look at. And of course, happy to have a conversation with any member prior to that to make sure I fully understand the key things that members want to see in that written agreement before drafts are produced.
Views?
Yeah.
Are we content with that approach?
Yes. Yeah.
Okay, thank you very much. In that case, we'll shortly go into private, but before we do, I'd like to make sure that we know that next week we'll be taking further evidence on fiscal framework, specifically this time on the aspects of welfare, and we'll also have an update on the Scotland Bill Committee. I now move this session into private session, this committee meeting into private session, and we'll just continue straight from now.